The Historical Society on BCTV is supported by the Highlands at Wyomissing.
Hello, and welcome to the Historical Society of Berks County's monthly program for April 2013. My name is Sime Bertolet. I'm the Executive Director of the Historical Society and your host for the show. Joining me, as usual, are Joshua Blay, Associate Director and Curator of the Historical Society.
Good evening, Sime.
Good evening, Josh. Seated next to Josh is Kimberly Richards Brown. Kim is the Director of Archives and Special Collections at the Henry Janssen Library. And also joining us tonight are two special friends of ours, Charlie Weiser and Margaret Patch from the Reading Symphony Orchestra.
Hello.
And they'll be good to have you with us. And they'll be joining us a little bit later to talk about a wonderful organization, bedrock of this community's social fiber, and an event that we've got going on in conjunction with the Reading Symphony Orchestra. I'd like to welcome all of you here tonight to the show. I would also like to remind you that this program is aired live the first Wednesday of every month at 7 p.m. If you don't catch it then, you can watch it the following Friday at 10 p.m., the Saturday right after that at 6 p.m., and then the following Sunday morning at 9 a.m. Just like to welcome you. And also, if you miss it there, you can also go to the BCTV archives and view past programs at that site.
And if you're watching us live right now today, we remind you that you can call in with your questions and comments to 610-378-0426. BCTV is certainly a treasure for our community and allows viewers like you to give us a call and interact with us with your questions and comments.
That's right. BCTV is a great part of this community. Where else do you get interactive programming that you have tonight that welcomes call-in viewers or viewers to call in with questions they might have of the panel? And I would urge all of you to support BCTV, and you can do so by as little as a $35 membership, and you can, for a year's membership, and you can help BCTV continue this programming. You can mail your check to BCTV at 645 Penn Street, Reading, Pennsylvania, 19601.
Our museum and Henry Janssen Research Library are open Tuesday through Saturday from 9 to 4. And whether you're here for the museum, the library, or both, please don't forget to come on into our museum store. Whether it's a basket woven by our own education curator, Vicki Hefner, a piece of Noldy Forest pottery, or a Berks County history book, we have a nice selection and ever-changing inventory of materials. And we have monthly specials. 10% is a usual member discount for our monthly special. We have an extra 10% and up on the table here if you get a chance to see it. We have two really good just-in-time for baseball season, a book on the Reading Phillies and a book by our very own Charlie Adams on the history of baseball in Reading. So that's a total of 20% if you're a member, just one of the very many discounts of being a member.
Yeah, and I would echo Josh's words. The Historical Society can be a part of this community only for one reason, that's through the support of its members, and we do need your support. And I encourage you to join the Historical Society to help us preserve Berks County's legacy. It's all of our heritage, and we can't do it without you. But Josh mentioned some of the discounts that you get for being a member of the Historical Society at our museum store. But in addition to that, you also get four issues of the Historical Review of Berks County. That's our quarterly journal that comes four times a year, and covers many, many interesting topics on Berks County's heritage. In addition to the Historical Review, you also get notices on upcoming programs, events, Second Saturday programs, other things like our Four Centuries in Berks Historic Property Tour. And while I'm on that subject, an additional benefit of membership to the Historical Society is that every member gets a ticket to the Four Centuries in Berks Historic Property Tour as part of their membership, and that's a $40 value. So for as little as $55 for an individual membership, where you get what I've just mentioned in addition to unlimited access to the HSBC Museum or the Henry Janssen Library, you can join also as a family, where you get all the benefits that I mentioned earlier, in addition to unlimited access to the museum and library for all family members living underneath one household. So 55 for an individual, 65 for family, and more if you just care to contribute to the Historical Society. And you can join either by coming by the Historical Society, and we're located at 940 Center Avenue. You can also call, and that's in Reading, you can also call in to 610-375-4375, or you can go to our website at www.berkshistory.org and join online. So there are many different ways that you can, and we encourage you to be a member of the Historical Society. Now, I think we're going to go on. We've done most of the housekeeping. Why don't we go on to some of the one of the events that we've got coming up at the Historical Society, important event, youth education program. Josh, why don't you tell us about
that? Certainly. As we say on the Historical Society, if it's winter and if it's early spring, it's Rainbow Theater season. Last few Saturdays, number of Saturdays, have been very busy with 14 kids diligently rehearsing for their upcoming play, Molly, an American Girl's Story. And the performances are coming up this weekend, April 5th, 6th, and 7th. However, April 5th is already sold out, so we have some openings on Saturday, April 6th at 7, and Sunday, April 7th at 3. The program is Molly, an American Girl's Story. It's a partnership between the Historical Society and Rainbow Theater. The program is appropriate for children ages 5 and older who must be accompanied by an adult. And ticket also includes, and this is a great value, admission to the museum on during the day of the performance. Reservations are required. It's only $12 for adult, $10 for children. Please give Judy Iwashenko, our receptionist and administrative assistant, a call at 610-375-4375 to reserve your tickets, because you do need a reservation. But again, there's only two open, Saturday, April 6th at 7 p.m., and Sunday, April 7th at 3 p.m., wow. And light refreshments are included.
So they sold two out of four?
Two out of four. So wow, we've really sold good. Out half the shows, and tickets have really, the Friday show sold out pretty quickly, okay. But the Saturday afternoon show sold out just this week. So give us a call if you want to see it. Great performance by 14
and
children.
And they call Judy at the History
yep,
of that.
Give Judy a call at our main number and check with her for reservation information. And get your reservation in.
How do you spell Iwashenko?
You know, you learn something.
Iwashenko. Anyway, okay.
And her email address, if you want to email her, it's judy.i@berkshistory.org. So we like to make nice and easy and simple, so it works out well.
That's really great. I mean, that is indicative of how popular that program is.
Oh,
they've
yeah.
already sold out two shows. Anyway, and it's, a great, it's a great show.
And a 1940s theme, so it's a really, yeah. really great show. I've seen a couple snippets of it, and the kids work so hard. 14 child actors, and it's a great program.
Well, and like you say, you get the anybody that comes gets admission to the museum, and as part of that, we have the hands-on history room. And the hands-on history room was the first interactive hands-on room in the county. I think it's 25 years old. It's going through a couple of iterations, but yeah, they've really done a great job
on
that.
And plus the two special exhibits, the portrait exhibit and also the Civil War exhibit, plus the whole rest of the building. So it's a great value.
Yeah, it really is.
Plus food.
Plus food.
If it's Berks County, it's got to work.
Sweet Street's donated.
Oh, yes. And thank you, Sandy Solomon, and all of your staff and employees at Sweet Street's. We appreciate you helping us out with this way. Thank you very kindly. Yeah, that's a good time. Okay, let's see. What else have we got? Now we're going to go from there. We're going to go talk to Kim about some of the things that are going on at the Henry Janssen Library.
Yes, we just finished our archival lecture series. Yay! We ended on March 23rd with a very good program by Michael Feeney.
Okay.
It was very good on funerary practices, funeral records, random stuff that popped into his head. It was very good.
For most people watching, that might not seem the most intriguing thing, but Mike did a great job.
He did it an hour and 45 minutes. It's by far the longest program that we did.
That's great. I mean, that speaks volumes.
It was
to
very
that.
Good.
And the audience was intact, too.
They were. None of them left. But on April 24th, this is a reminder that the HJL Book Club will meet at 5 o'clock in the Henry Janssen Library. The book for this month is entitled The First Frontier, The Forgotten History of Struggle, Savagery, and Endurance in Early America by Scott Weinsall, who's actually up in Schuylkill County. To kind of give you a little bit of background, the book is a history of kind of mostly North America. It touches a little on South America, before and during the time of colonization, as I have when the American West was only a few feet away from the Atlantic Ocean.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it's really like when we're the West. Anybody who has made an attempt reading the book, because it is a history book and sometimes you end up with academic books, which this is one of them. Anybody who has made an attempt at reading the book is more than welcome to join us. You do not have to finish the book to participate in the discussion. We ask that everybody make a $5 donation to the Adopt a Collection Fund, and we also ask that you bring your own dinner. We'll provide the beverages. So it's a brown bag one. And this is key. If you want a say in the next book, you have to come to this this one, because we always choose the book for the next meeting at the day of the meeting. So if you want to get in on what we're reading, you got to show up for the discussion. So.
Are there any themes that are, do you find yourself going in a theme now that, there's a topic that seems to resonate with the...
We're all over the board. The
really?
First book was Berks County, because there was enemies in the rear.
Yeah.
The second book was The Day Lincoln Was Shot. The third book was A Midwife's Tale. It was the story of Martha Ballard. And then we did The First Frontier. We're going to try to go or persuade the group to do more of a narrative, upbeat history book.
Okay.
Because they're hit or miss. I mean, if you're a student of history, you know you're either going to get a very academic and dry book, or you're going to get something that's a little bit faster to read and more narrative-like.
Okay.
So we've done two academic books in a row, so we're going to see where it kind of all plays out. We've got a range of topics to cover. So.
Yeah, my interest generally gravitates towards foods culture, but that gets kind of a
academic. It's like reading a cookbook.
Well, it's not like reading a cookbook. I'm trying, how that influences society. But yeah, Weiss Weaver was a good when he was here did his presentation. William Weiss Weaver does a wonderful job at talking about the culinary traditions of the Pennsylvania Dutch. How we got, how that drove our culture and, how food was so much of a part of it. But, that sounds good.
We'll add some. We have a couple of your suggestions on the list. So.
You do?
Yeah.
Okay.
Because we kind of created a master list just to help take the pressure off of the group from coming up with books. So one of your, we were tempted to put your thesis on it, but we can't reproduce it.
You can't. Why not?
Well, actually, if you give us permission, we could.
Oh. Knock yourself out.
I
got to have somebody read that besides my professors, all right? What else you got, Kim?
Well, I brought up the topic of Adopt a Collection. As you know, for the past couple of years, we have been trying to raise funds to help process collections. And I've brought in an example of what that money does for us. I'm going to give a nice hello and shout out to one of our new volunteers, Jeff Gruth, who I know is watching. He is diligently working in our basement making boxes for our ledgers. So this is an actual box. We can get sheets of cardboard. We're right now averaging about two ledgers per box. But when we start getting into the bigger ones,
show them what's in that.
It's going to cost a little more. But this is one of the Jones scrapbooks, and we're in these quite frequently. But what it allows us to do is it allows us to, what you need to understand is if you go down into the basement, you're going to see rows and rows and rows of ledgers like these wrapped in brown paper.
I was going to say you
should have like the grocery paper. I couldn't do it because it's just bad. It's not archival. It's acid. So what we are working on doing is actually forming these boxes around the ledgers. And what that does is it takes the weight of, additional ledgers on top, distributes it amongst the box, and keeps everything all nice and tight.
And each one of those has to be a custom made.
Each one is custom made, because I brought in as another example, there's this one, which is a long, kind of odd looking ledger book.
And you said it was just cardboard, but it's not just
it's
cardboard.
It's our acid free.
Yeah. Blue board.
Yeah. Acid-free we actually can order our record storage cartons this color.
Right. But that doesn't impart, and that regular cardboard is has acid.
Acid, yeah. This is all stuff that's been treated. You can't really tell, but there's like a kind of like a sheen to it, so it's coated. Mm-hmm. You can actually get these, and we didn't do it, but you can get them waterproofed because they make acid-free boxes that are waterproofed. But it's a huge task because we've got a gazillion ledgers and scrapbooks that we have to do this to, and so.
And you know, that's not an exaggeration. Yeah. A gazillion may be a little bit, but you've got thousands of these.
So you know, we'd like to thank the people who contributed. I know Brian Engelhart, who is a real dear friend to the Henry Janssen Library, through a donation on behalf of his sister, we were able to process the Stewart Day School collection and the Montessori School. So you know. Your money and contributions really do go and help the, you know, with our collection storage and our collection preservation. So consider, you know, helping us box more books.
Well, if, like I said, if citizens of Berks County want to make sure this is a, you know, that these sources and this material is around, you know, for future generations, 200 and 300 years hence, this is the what we have to go through to make sure that, you know, we fulfill that mission.
So once it's gone.
Yeah, once it's gone, it's gone forever.
You're never going to get it back.
Yeah, you're not.
So this is our history that we are trying to save.
So, well, that's great, Kim. Anything else?
That's it.
Okay, all right. Well, okay, as I mentioned earlier, we have two very special guests on tonight. Margaret Patch and Charlie Weiser, both from the Reading Symphony Orchestra. And back in the fall, I guess it was actually earlier, in the earlier part of 2012, Margaret and Penny Proserpi actually came to me and said, Sime, it's the 100th anniversary of the Reading Symphony Orchestra, and we'd like to know if you would like to, you know, do a collaborative effort to help the Reading Symphony Orchestra celebrate their 100th anniversary, which is taking place in 2013. The first thing that impressed me the most about it was that they came a year in advance, and they ask me that question. Most of the times when I get requests like that, oh, it's about 8-10 weeks, you know, and it's, so it was great to have them come but to the Historical Society. But that's what the Historical Society is all about. Our mission is to preserve the history and the legacy of Berks County. And so any time that we can engage in a collaborative effort, such as celebrating the 100th anniversary of the Reading Symphony Orchestra, or we're also celebrating the 250th of the Reading Public Library. We like those collaborative efforts. It's good for the community, and it's good for the organizations. And so I'd like to welcome both Margaret, Charlie, here to the program tonight, and thank you. And let's just start talking about the Reading Symphony.
Indeed.
Well, yes, we did approach in 2012. I didn't mark on my calendar, but it would be interesting for Penny and me to figure out when did this all begin, because it feels like it's been a long journey. I'm left with all kinds of learning from this latest developmental opportunity, Charlie, and that is 1913 must have been an amazing year in Reading, Pennsylvania.
Okay.
With the symphony beginning, not just saying, let's have a concert. Charlie will tell you in a few minutes that this began as a plan to establish a symphony. Mm-hmm. The library, of course, has been flourishing. The museum celebrates its 100th anniversary. So there's a little part of me. Yes,
Chamber of Commerce.
Yes.
Chamber of Commerce, 100th anniversary.
There's a little part of me that would like to be back and say, 1913 was magic.
Yeah.
And here we are in 2013. And we're very proud of an organization, the Reading Symphony Orchestra, that not only is flourishing, we're operating financially in a solvent mode, and we work very hard at that.
Congratulations.
And we take that and take it with a great deal of responsibility. But it's a true gem. And anyone who has heard it knows that they want to come back, and those that haven't, we encourage you to try it. So how do you celebrate a 100th anniversary? Well, part of it is we wanted to extend to the entire community.
Mm-hmm.
We wanted to look to the future and the next 100 years. And our initial working title was RSO 100, The Second Century Begins.
Okay.
So we are just almost completing the RSO 100, And our season brochure for next year is 101, The Second Century Begins. So we are looking forward, but also what a rich history to look back upon. And our first activity, as Sime heard, was we wanted the whole community involved. So a year ago, we launched Beat Beethoven. And I'm truly doing a commercial message, ladies and gentlemen, because not only did we have 575 runners on the Alvernia campus with a 125-piece orchestra and probably 1,000 spectators, but we're doing it again on April 28th. And I want to encourage all of you who wish to run to sign up at Pretzel City Sports or the Symphony office. If you don't think you can run, you can walk. If you don't want to walk, you can come listen to the orchestra. There's something for everyone, and it's on the Alvernia campus, which is just beautiful and lends itself wonderfully to the event. So that's the commercial message. But now we began, and of course it was the 100th anniversary, so let's have a birthday party. And thanks to Sweet Street Desserts, we launched a birthday party for the first concert in the fall. And this year it's been a series of activities, all that were intended to live within our budget and also celebrate the music. What we didn't realize, was we had a secret weapon in the recent retirement of Charles Weiser. Because as soon as he didn't get a paycheck, he launched himself into doing an amazing, wonderful gift to the Reading Symphony and the community of really putting our archival works in order. And he even did it in an entertaining style. We've had a lot of lunches, we've had a lot of laughs, and we've worked hard. But Charlie can tell us a great deal of what he has learned that we then shared with the Historical Society. Mm-hmm. And we'll tell you a little bit more about what we've shared at the Historical Society in a few minutes. But let's let Charlie have a few words about what he's discovered about the RSO.
Okay, Margaret. And thanks to all of you folks from the Historical Society for having us here tonight, and also for the whole concept of sharing all of your resources. Because it was in your basement, some of those scrapbooks that need those wrappers, that we found a lot more information about the RSO than we knew. A volunteer by the name of Wayne Beeler had done a tremendous effort organizing old programs and clippings and so forth, but there were big gaps, and we'd uncovered them in great fashion through you folks, through the Reading Eagle Company, which has just been very supportive of all the efforts. And Margaret alluded to it, that 1913 was a special year, not only here, but around the country. A lot of symphonies were beginning, and we know that we were probably in the top 20 as far as continuing orchestras, but we're probably at about the top 10 of orchestras that never stop performing. And that is really where I'd kind of like to begin. And we have some slides to show, if we can do that, that what made us unique was that the music really never stopped in Berks County. We had musicians in town, we had an audience, and we even had the train that was available to easily bring musicians to the town. But there you see it. The first concert was in November of 1913, and here we are in our 100th season. Okay, Josh. And here's a clip not to be read unless you work for an eye doctor, but this is the announcement of, as Margaret alluded, this wasn't just we're going to put on a concert, you all come. This was four concerts that were mapped out, the dates were all given, and by gosh, they came. The people came, and everything worked out for it. So that was the announcement. The next slide shows that indeed it was a success. And it was just one of those situations. This was in late November, November 30th, 1913. And one of those great tidbits was all the way across the state in Erie, Pennsylvania, the Erie Philharmonic gave its first concert on November 30th, 1913. Only difference is the Depression and both wars interrupted their service. So
their service.
Their service.
But not Reading.
Nope, it never stopped. We continued in every season. Yep. In 1932, we only gave three concerts instead of the usual four. There were no soloists, but there it is. Do you want to interrupt? There's a
well,
viewer.
If you
the
do,
question?
I guess there's a home viewer.
Anytime.
Home viewer. Are you with us?
Hello. Can I ask you a question, sir?
Sure. Me or Charlie or?
No, you directly, buddy.
Okay.
Okay. Can I ask you when our dear friend George is going to be back, if he ever comes back?
I will tell you that George has made the decision that it's time for him to take a break. No, unfortunately, George is not going to be back on the show. He has decided that, it's been enough time. We're very sorry for him making that decision. George has made such a wonderful contribution to Reading and Berks County and this program. And we're sorry, but we understand. And I'm sorry to say that, no, he's not. Well, that never is a long time, but at this point...
Well, I miss his photos and stuff. He always did. I miss that. I look forward to that.
I'm sure we all do. We all do.
Well, Simon, in honor of George, I'll do the next line that... may I have the next slide, please?
Okay.
Which is
thank you, caller. We appreciate you calling in.
Thank
just
you,
as
Cy.
George
you
would
bet.
Have done it.
Bye-bye.
Bye now.
There you go, Carol. He's done.
Yeah. And this is the first photo of the symphony that we knew of this photo. It had been around.
It's forever to find.
I know. It was around, but we couldn't get it documented. And then here it turned up on the fourth program of the first year. Now, even a trombone player can figure out if it's on the cover February 24th, that it February 22nd, 1914, it had to be taken before that. And eventually Kim found it in the basement.
Lisa
and
found it.
Oh, Lisa.
We have to get
ooh,
Lisa
I knew that was Lisa found it. I'll hear about that. Lisa found it and made it available. And right now, along with a lot of the other archive items of the symphony, you can view them at the Historical Society through May 11th. And run, don't walk, to come to the Historical Society to see the display. Penny and Margaret have done a great job putting these things together, and it'll be great. Let's move ahead, Josh. And this was the article that came with that fourth concert, and it's special because it was on Washington's birthday. And Washington's birthday at the turn of the century, or the early part of the century, was a big deal. There was bunting and flowers, and the mayor was feted and was brought out, and it was just a huge, huge deal. And something we just learned recently is that that concert completely sold out, and they turned people away, and the committee that ran the symphony said, I think we ought to repeat this. So the next week, 1 week later, on Sunday, March 1st, this entire concert was repeated.
Wow.
Now that's breaking news, because they say that they were looking to do it, but we couldn't find the records that it actually took place. And just recently, in the last month, we found that indeed we add another concert to our history, March 1st, 1914.
Huh.
Go ahead. This is the gentleman who was the first conductor of the orchestra, Harry Farbach. And Harry was a bandsman. He conducted the Philharmonic Band, and as all of the groups of those days, Ringgold and some of the others, the Cadet, they had orchestra contingents. A lot of the guys played string instruments, and they would do orchestral music, but not in a real organized fashion. And by 1913, enough people had them stirred up, and they got going, organized. And that's how it began, and Harry was the conductor for the first 10 years.
Hmm.
Another very important man in the early history of the orchestra was Otto Wittig. Many remember Wittig's music store. Well, Otto was involved in that operation, and he was the principal violin, which in the orchestra world we call the concertmaster, for 38 years. Hmm. And I mentioned that Harry Farbach had been a bandsman, and Otto helped Harry know more about the orchestra world and the conducting, and there it is.
What, for a neophyte, and like you said, the concertmaster generally is the first violin.
Yep, always.
Always. Okay, yeah. And how was, is there a reason that that was established, or I mean, is it just because more string-driven, or?
Yeah, the concertmaster of any orchestra gives a lot of directions, mm-hmm. a lot of instructions to not only his first violins, but to the second violins and his colleagues in the other part of the string world.
Okay.
Next to the conductor, he's the most important person on the stage. Yeah.
Okay.
And then there's a battle for the next third one after that. probably depends who buys
the speaker of the
best string. Yeah, it's the speaker of the house. That's right.
Okay.
It's not the triangle player.
It's not the triangle player unless you're doing Brahms third. Then you need a triangle. Go ahead, Josh. Yeah, this I show this one for a couple of reasons. This is a typical program from the early years. And again, the Historical Society, through Otto Wittig's gifts, has many, many of these first years. Some that the Symphony Office itself does not have, but Otto preserved them, and you can see these. If you come into the library and say, I'd like to see Otto Wittig's program collection.
It's the name of the collection.
It is. Lisa will go down and at Kim's direction, and we'll bring up these folders. And they're really fascinating to see. This one, you see, it is newly named the Raja Theater that formerly was the Academy of Music, and it's been our home for literally all of the 100 years, except when there was a fire at the theater, and a couple times when maybe the heat broke down 3 weeks ago. No, I'm just kidding about that, but the Raja has always been the home. Of course, it became the Sovereign Performing Arts Center in 2001, 2002, I believe. The other point is the soloist was a guy named Thaddeus Rich, and he was the concertmaster of the Philadelphia Orchestra. Hmm. And almost every concertmaster of Philly has been a soloist with Reading. As recently as this year, David Kim, the current concertmaster at the orchestra, and he'll be back next fall playing with a concertmaster from the Baltimore Symphony, and they'll be doing duo. So it'll be dueling concert masters of two of the finest orchestras in the world. Yeah. Go ahead. Here we have one of my favorite stories. Orchestra, everybody loves kids. Orchestra players and audiences love kids. This is a Gloria Perkins, who was a child prodigy, soloed with the orchestra, and kept on playing for many, many years, lived into her 90s and taught and so forth. But if you're a little kid and you have to sign an autograph, the next slide will show what Gloria's autograph looked like. And there you can see Gloria signed her name on the line. She wasn't Palmer Method. It was well done and displayed it right there.
How old was she?
She was about 10 right then.
Really?
To show you how popular she was, she came 2 years in a row, which is very unusual for solos to come back to back. Go ahead, John. One of the next conductors was Hans Kindler, who was here in the 30s and brought in a lot of youth concerts, got things started for that, did a great job. And at the same time he was working here, he was in Washington, D.C., beginning the National Symphony, which of course is one of the great symphonies of today. But for about 8 years, he did both of the orchestras. He was a incredible cello soloist. And there is, it's hard to see this, but this was a youth concert in the 1930s that Kindler provided. And down at the bottom, you can see there was assembly singing that the kids actually sang along, Three Blind Mice. They did rounds, and this was the beginning. And orchestras around the country really began this in the 1920s, 1930s.
That was a movement, because you still have
your kinder
concerts right now.
Kinder concerts and our student concerts for the community, for the schools, probably around 6,000 every year. Students get to hear the orchestra.
And by way of commercial, the next kinder concert will be May 5th at 2 p.m.
Great.
May 5th
at 2 p.m. And that's going to be at SPAC.
Mm-hmm.
So Sovereign Performing Arts.
And that'll be featuring the youth orchestra this year. The Reading Symphony Youth Orchestra will be performing that concert.
Oh, great.
Get them more involved.
Wonderful.
Go ahead. So popular these were that this was page one in the 1930s that music lovers crashed the gates, and literally they just only the fire marshal was able to control, but they had them seated in the aisles and in the front and everywhere that was legal in order to get to it, because that's how popular they were on a Saturday morning. This wasn't at a school time getting out of geography class. This was a Saturday activity.
And the program was not difficult.
The program was not difficult.
That's great.
Cute.
And here we have, these are the conductors, Harry Farbach, Walter Pfeiffer, Hans Kindler, Andre Pollau, who Josh from Syracuse, I told, had been at Syracuse after he left us. He was only here, as they would say, for a cup of coffee for one season. Saul Kasten was here during the war, and he was a principal trumpet player of the Philly Orchestra. Alexander Hillsburg was their concertmaster at that time, and he was here many years. Louis Viner worked with Stokowski, and Sidney Rothstein was here for 30 seasons.
Wow.
By far the most of any of the conductors, and Sid's very, very supportive.
And Charlie, this connection with the Philadelphia Orchestra is really significant for the life of the RSO, isn't it?
Yeah, it really was, because even in the very beginning, a lot of talented musicians in Reading, but they knew that to have a principal oboe or to have two bassoons of top quality play all the repertoire, they developed a relationship with Philly, and those guys came up for many, many years. And one of my favorite points was when they hand out the loving cups for 25 years or retirement. Some of the Philadelphia Orchestra guys came up 40 seasons.
And really?
It was their Sunday home, because the concerts were Sunday afternoon, and they'd take the train, do one rehearsal, play a show, and then
had lunch.
They had lunch at the Crystal.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, the Crystal restaurant was a big deal.
And they had the Reading Railroad.
The frequency of the rail service from both New York and Philly was really important. During the war, V for Victory, the Morse code for that is da 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 for the letter V, and which is the opening of Beethoven's Fifth. So patriotic. Times you had the V for Victory on the cover with the Morse code, and
with the German composer.
It was a German composer, but they didn't mind.
That's okay. In Berks County, what do you expect?
No, in Berks County, the symphony played a lot of Wagner. You didn't turn away Wagner because of that. Because they reasoned correctly that Wagner didn't know Hitler. So it worked out.
Well, during the Depression, they still drank a lot of beer, too. There is something about the culture.
There is, indeed. Go ahead. These are totally unreadable names, but to know that this is the formative list of the Reading Symphony Women's Committee, and that volunteer group is still strong, known as the Reading Symphony Orchestra League, but they were featured in the programs in the 30s, and just an important part of the life in the symphony.
Major fundraising.
Indeed.
Mm. Well, it is a really engaged organization. I mean, again, we go back to not only the league, but when we talk about organizing this exhibit, I mean, the effort that you and that Penny and the Charlie and so many other individuals put into the exhibit that we have at the Historical Society right now. Really shows the amount of engagement. I mean, it's
and there are just many, many people that are doing that level of work, and with passion. I can't even begin to think about the number of years some of the people have been members of the league, or members, people that have attended the symphony for 60 years and beyond. Tom Souter studied with Otto Wittig, didn't he?
He did indeed.
We've got a continuity here that's quite a story to tell.
That's wonderful. I mean, it's to your credit. It's just, that's great.
Yeah. Okay, Josh. I think we can move along pretty quickly. And here's a photo of Gertrude Sternberg, who at her home in Sterling. And Gertrude was a soloist with the orchestra 10 different times. graduate of the Juilliard School, and just was the key patroness of the arts for many, many years. And the folks at the Sterling Guest Hotel still make the space available to us for events, and it's just a great part of the history.
Charlie, Margaret, one of the things that we did...
Yeah, just going to say, tell them about your night.
Because we needed to celebrate the legacy of Gertrude Sternberg and how important she was to the RSO. So we had an evening at Sterling called If These Walls Could Talk.
Yeah.
And we had five people who spoke about their reflections of days with, as in Diana Tyrion's case, Aunt Gertrude.
Mm-hmm.
And just reminiscing about what it was like. And one of the things that touched me most was one of the people that had been a guest in Gertrude's house repeatedly who came up to me afterward and said, I felt like we were back again. We positioned the piano exactly where it was for when Gertrude was there, and we had it set up the way she had had it. And it was a time to reflect on how important she was to the Reading Symphony. She hosted world-famous musicians repeatedly in her home and encouraged them to come and determined the program for many years, didn't she, Charlie?
Indeed, yeah, she had controlling factors with the conductors, and very, very knowledgeable. And when you say, why did the orchestra never stop playing, she certainly was
major
one of the
driving force.
She was.
Well, I mean, I've heard some of them, but tell the audience, for those who might not be aware, who were some of the people that she did bring to Reading, you know?
Well, certainly one was Andre Watts. And as a young pianist, she helped him, and so did Louis Viner, who was the conductor. Mm-hmm. And Andre lived at the Sterling home for a period of time, and he was a soloist many times. John Browning was here oftentimes. Rosalind Turek, one of the fine pianists of the era. It was the place to be.
And the board meetings were held in the center meeting room.
Oh, really?
And they didn't really take the formality that we have today. Board members might have numbered five or six, maybe, Charlie?
No, a little more than that, but it was organized in the 20s that nonprofit laws came into place, and Reading Musical Foundation took its place in assisting, but it still was a small cadre of people, and the budget was very small. At the end of the year, they would write a check and cover any deficit if there was anything, and it was a simpler world at that point.
Yes, it was a simpler world.
Although
putting it mildly,
checks are still gratefully received.
Yeah, understatement.
Okay.
Well, that's great. Go ahead.
That's Louis Viner, we spoke about, the conductor for many years. And Wes Fisher, you couldn't this program without speaking of Wes Fisher, who was with the orchestra as a bassist, as a manager and librarian, Mr. Reading, Mr. Music in Reading for years, associated with the symphony for 55 years.
And many of the musicians today were initially brought in by Wes.
Yeah,
is that
yours truly included. And this was before one of the Grings Mill concerts. In fact, playing the bass drum is Robin Henshaw, who was the director of the parks. And you see Henry Goss in the back with Wes, and the young lady holding the flute in the front, I'll mention, as she is my wife of a number of years and flutist with the symphony for 50 years. Anne Garrett Weiser just celebrated her 50th anniversary with the orchestra.
And Charlie has figured out that she has performed with the symphony 450 times.
Yeah, at least.
Whoa.
Yeah. More than anybody else.
And that back on the rock, you'll see someone with a trombone.
Yeah, there it is.
Right.
Yes.
You?
That's me. torturing the turtle.
The Weiser family has supported the orchestra both in performance and in management for over 100 years.
And Brian Holtz up there in the front on the drum, and Jan Dixon, who is a cellist, for some reason, was handed a viola that day. But
it shows that she's flexible.
The price must have been right. Okay, that was before the Grings Mill concerts. There's a good shot of Henry, who was assistant conductor for many years. And two soloists, and again, some family connections. That at the top of the screen is Rebecca Goss Butler, Henry's daughter is our keyboardist. And in the front is Bruce Bengston, wonderful soloist for many, many years. And there is Bruce's son, Matthew, along with Sidney and board president Stuart Dunford at the time. And three wonderful volunteers. In the center is Dr. Jack Lush, who was president of the board recently, and Fern Carabella, who was the wife of a former president, Charles Carabella, and Gene Blickle, who's currently on the board and a wonderful volunteer.
And there's so many, you've talked about and mentioned so many names that, again, not only through this exhibit, but also through the memberships, how closely the Historical Society and the, and the RSO are...
Sharing people.
Yeah, sharing people. It's really nice that, you know, we have a community that supports organizations such as ours.
It's a wonderful award that came from a cookbook that was generated and raised how much money for the orchestra?
$250,000.
$250,000.
114,000 cookbooks.
114,000. Mm-hmm. Yeah. What kind of time period did you sell those things in?
I didn't have gray hair before we started. actually, we sold them over about 4 or 5 years.
And Sovereign
That's
Bank.
Wonderful.
Sovereign Bank was
bought
very
a huge
generous.
Amount for a promotion.
For sure.
That they
yeah.
had. But this was the award on the editorial work. And
this was for
Penny
the,
and Margaret did that.
The best volunteer cookbook in the region.
Yeah.
I can imagine.
Mm-hmm.
And they are all sold now.
Do we have one?
We don't have one in the archives?
I can make one available for that purpose.
We do need one for the archives.
We need one in the archives.
You just mooched a cookbook.
Yes. It will be delivered.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Go ahead, Josh. And this is one of Sydney's favorite shots. New Year's Eve, we started the tradition of the fireworks on Mount Penn behind the pagoda, and this was the promo shot for it the first time. And this is Sidney again at one of his proud moments at the Astor Theater performance of Beethoven Ninth, when they were trying to determine if that was the best place to make the art center, and it didn't work out that way. The Astor sadly wasn't the finest acoustical place, and for many other reasons it wasn't preserved.
But, speaking of Beethoven's Ninth, we will be concluding our season this year with Beethoven 9 on May 11.
Okay.
And that will be with the Baltimore Choral Arts Society.
Mm-hmm.
So
May
I 11. Encourage
mm-hmm,
yeah.
it will be a wonderful way to conclude a glorious year.
Mm-hmm. Josh, we're almost done. This is one of our favorite soloists. Was a narrator, and that, of course, is Severin Fairman, mm-hmm. who has done so much work in the community, spreading the word of the Holocaust and remembrances, and he narrated a piece by Arnold Schoenberg called A Survivor from Warsaw. And Donna Klein, who runs the office so diligently as far as for ticket sales and so forth, presenting Sidney at his last show with lifetime tickets. And Christopher Lee, our wonderful current concertmaster, who's a soloist many times and a true treasure, this is his 10th year. And there are the number of soloist top appearances. There, Sime, are some of those names. John Browning, yeah.
Andre Watts,
Susan Starr, Chris, Thompson. Ken Regal from Wummelsdorf, Aaron Roseanne, and Bonita Valente.
Do you know what was the first symphony orchestra in the United States? You have any idea? I mean, did they all, is there?
New York?
The oldest is the New York Phil. The New York Philharmonic combined probably 1820s, 1840s.
Okay, pretty early, okay.
Yeah, it's quite a bit. And the choral societies in Boston, they're very old. And actually, our own choral society is well over 100 years.
Okay.
The choral society is probably 130 by now.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah, the choral groups started a little bit earlier.
Was there, but for the 100th, you know, 1913, was there, did you see a wave in the United States? Was there a wave?
Economically, there were a lot of smaller cities that could afford it.
Mm-hmm.
It was the thing to do. The business people saw the things to do it, so that's kind of why there was a way. But most of them discontinued or reorganized uh-huh. in many ways. Your own Syracuse is an example. That folded a couple of years ago
yep.
and is now reorganizing
yes,
again.
It is, yeah.
Yeah. Yep. These are the top composers. No real surprises there. And these are the top 10 tunes.
These are the most played.
Most played, yeah. Brahms first yeah. led the list.
Wagner's number three.
Yeah.
Yeah, Meistersinger.
Charlie has worked on this for the last, it feels like, couple of years.
Yeah, indeed. Well, and Excel spreadsheets help.
Yes.
And this was the great day after a whole year of a search, after Sidney decided to step down, that Andrew Constantine was named, and the announcement was at Stirling with a grand event. So there's Sidney literally passing the baton. And there's the man of the hour, our wonderful conductor who's in his sixth season, and many more to come, we hope. And there he is working the baseball crowd, doing his duty on July 4th, mm-hmm. even though he was on the losing team.
And we will be having the Star Spangled Spectacular again this year.
Again this yeah. year?
It's always a full house and a lot of fun, and it's open to the public free of charge.
Really? Mm-hmm. Wow, wonderful. Yeah.
And the last line, there's the party shot. 100 years of the orchestra.
And I just want you to know that it took a great deal of intellect to blow up all those balloons. we did it twice. We did it yeah. for the picture, and then we did it again for the first concert. Mm-hmm. And that really represents 100 years of continuous performance. Mm-hmm.
So I hope you viewers will come out to the Historical Society to see the display of all these archives that goes till May 11th.
Yeah, it's wonderful, and it's been great to have. I can't believe, you know, a year or more has passed since we started. Yeah. This time just flies. Yeah. Are you seeing any trends, I mean, in the symphony or the music that you're playing? I mean, do you see any significant trends that you notice, or is it pretty much of a constant?
Well, we have more single-ticket buyers. Because a lot of folks don't subscribe to the amount that they did 30 years ago because there's so many offerings.
Uh-huh.
And yet, that said, we have probably more subscribers than 80% of the orchestra. So just really wonderful.
Well, that's great. Well, it's been wonderful.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity.
Absolutely. And we say happy birthday to the Reading Symphony Orchestra.
And we really thank the Historical Society for collaborating with us. It's been fun to share all of this.
Well, great. We enjoyed doing it. We really did.
Thank you.
It's been a great relationship.
The cookbook will be in the mail.
Thank you.
Well, okay, can you up on the graphics monitor, can you punch that up? We want to also say this, the photograph, man in this photograph is Jonathan L. Shalter III, a conservationist, naturalist, and historian. And Jonathan, along with the Reading Symphony Orchestra, will celebrate his 100th birthday on Friday, April 5th. Jonathan has taken many beautiful photographs of the Berks County area over the years. His historical photographs of Berks County have been featured in many publications, including the Historical Society's Passing Scene, as well as Mike Reinert's Channel 69 Time Train. We'd like to offer Jonathan our best wishes on his 100th birthday, and many more to come. Jonathan, bless you, and happy birthday. Joshua, do you have anything to take us out of the show with?
Yeah, I got some here I can crowbar here in 30 seconds,
okay,
I think, or maybe
just
maybe 32 seconds. 40 years ago today, this very date, April 3rd, marks an anniversary for the very first cell phone call in the world.
Wow.
I saw that.
Yes, I saw this video trivia this afternoon. Now, the first commercial cell phone was not available for another 10 years after that. So this year also marks the 30th year of the first cell phone that you could buy for yourself. It cost $4,000 and weighed 2.5 pounds. But here's the real reason I bring this up. I wanted to bring a phone in to go along with that little tidbit. We have no phones in our collection. Absolutely no phones.
No, wait, what kind? No cell phones or no phones?
No phones whatsoever. Cell phones, corded phones, you name it. So
don't answer cell phone. You got plenty of
that. We actually might be interested in an old cell phone, but here's where we need your help. We would love to have an example of a candle phone, it's called a candlestick phone, it's the old cradle phones, a magnetophone, a rotary phone, and what they call a pink princess phone. And it has to be used in Berks County. It has to be in good shape. It has to be clean. But give me a call, 610-375-4375. It's time for us to get into the 20th and the 21st century, and yes, even an old cell phone.
Okay. I'd like to see one of those big handheld phones.
Certainly.
I guess it's time that to close out the show. We thank you for joining us tonight. I ask that you tell your friends about our monthly television program, and I'll also ask you and thank you for your support, and ask you to tell your friends, if they're not members of the Historical Society, we would love to have them join us. Our organization keeps the legacy of Berks County alive for this and future generations, and without us there to do it, it wouldn't happen. And once it's gone, as Kim said, it's gone forever. We thank you, but we're not gone forever. We'll be seeing you next month when we'll host the May program of the Historical Society of Berks County. Until then, thank you for joining us. All the best.
The Historical Society on BCTV is supported by the Highlands at Wyomissing.